Hello everyone, welcome to Brain Blitz Audios. In today's episode of NEET Preparation, we'll be dealing with previous year questions of chemistry in medical entrance examinations in India. Today we'll be dealing with the chapter Structure of Atom. This is the second chapter in the grade 11 syllabus for CBSE. Let's move to our first question of this episode. Find the frequency of light that corresponds to photons of energy 5.0 into 10 raised to minus 5 erg. So we have four options. We need to find out which of these is the right option by solving the question. And we need to find the frequency of light. How do we do it? Well, according to the photoelectric effect, energy is equal to Planck's constant times the frequency of light. Therefore, we can write the frequency of light as energy divided by Planck's constant. Now, the energy given here is 5.0 into 10 raised to minus 5 erg divided by Planck's constant is 6.63 into 10 raised to minus 34 joule second. Now, if you notice in the Planck's constant, it's given as joule second while the energy is given in ergs. So we need to convert the Planck's constant in terms of erg second. So we know that 1 joule is equal to 10 raised to 7 erg. So we just need to multiply 10 raised to 7 to the denominator. So 5.0 into 10 raised to minus 5 erg divided by 6.63 into 10 raised to minus 34 into 10 raised to 7 erg second. Now, what do we do to solve this question? The units of frequency will be second inverse, and the significant figures 5.0 divided by 6.63 remains the same. We can now play with the powers of 10. So we have 10 raised to minus 5 divided by 10 raised to minus 34 into 10 raised to 7. So when we take them to the numerator, we'll get 10 raised to minus 5 minus 7 plus 34. So that will be equal to 5.0 divided by 6.63 into 10 raised to 22 second inverse. Now over here, let's simplify the numerator and the denominator. And the way we do that is, since because we have decimals in the denominator, let's multiply both sides so that both the numerator and the denominator are whole numbers. So in this case, we need to convert 6.63 into 663, so multiply by 100 in the denominator. So in order to negate it, we have to multiply by 100 in the numerator as well. So we get 500 divided by 663 into 10 raised to 22 second inverse. Now you see that 500 is less than 663. So what we do is we take a 10 from 10 raised to 22. So it'll be 5,000 divided by 663 into 10 raised to 21 second inverse. And now we can stop, because if you look at our options carefully, you find that all of these have the term 7.5. So we can assume that 5,000 divided by 663 will give you 7.5 something. The important thing to note is the power of 10 and the unit. In the first question, it's 10 raised to minus 21 second inverse, but what we get is 10 raised to 21, so A is incorrect. For option B, the unit as well as the power of 10 is incorrect. For option D, the power of 10 is correct, but the unit is incorrect. The right answer is option C, 7.5 into 10 raised to 21 second inverse. And we did that without having to divide 5,000 by 663. And if you do 5,000 by 663, you'll get 7.54 something. So in order to, you know, verify our answer, let's write it down. So 359 and 0, so 3315 and 275, and then it goes on. The division goes on. But we didn't need to do this division in order to find out the answer due to the framing of our question. So that makes option C the right option. Let's move on to our next question. The ratio of energy of a photon of wavelength 3000 angstrom and 6000 angstrom is 3:1, 2:1, 1:2, 1:3. So, how do we solve this question? Here we use the Planck-Einstein relation. So energy is related to wavelength by the following formula, E is equal to hc by lambda. Now this is the same thing as E is equal to h nu, except that here we put the formula of nu as c by lambda. So we got E is equal to hc by lambda. So that would give you the relation that E is inversely proportional to lambda. So when we divide two energies of photons, that is E1 and E2 respectively, you would find that their wavelengths will be 1 by lambda 1 divided by 1 by lambda 2. This is the ratio of their wavelengths. And on simplifying it, you'll get lambda 2 divided by lambda 1. Let's write the values of the wavelengths. So that'll be 6,000 divided by 3,000. So angstroms, angstroms. So angstrom, angstrom gets canceled. 3,000 goes into 6,000 two times. So that is 2:1. So therefore, the ratio E1 is to E2 will be equal to 2:1. This is our ratio. And that is expressed by option B. So that is the right option. Option B, 2:1, is the ratio of the energy of a photon, of photons of wavelengths 3000 angstrom and 6000 angstrom. Let's move on to our next question. Which of the following combinations of quantum numbers is allowed? Now, before we start doing this, let's review what quantum number combinations look like. So n is the principal quantum number, and it has the and it ranges from 1 to infinity, essentially the natural numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. And L starts from 0, and it moves on to n minus 1. So supposedly, if n has 3, the value of L can stretch from 0 to n minus 1, which is 2. And M, which is the orbital quantum number, that stretches from minus L to plus L. So here L refers to the maximum value of the azimuthal quantum number L. And MS is the spin quantum number. Now this can be, that this is always minus half or half because this depicts the spin. So all electrons are spinning either in the positive or negative direction. So there will always be minus half or plus half as a spin quantum number. Let's check out our combinations. In combination A, it's given that N is 3. This is plausible. L is 2. Again, correct, because 2 is 3 minus 1. And M is 1. Again, correct. It lies between minus L to plus L. But the spin quantum number is given as 0, which is not true, because spin quantum number can either be minus half or plus half, because every electron has characteristic spin. So option A is incorrect. What about option D? N is 1, L is 0, so far so good. However, here M is given as 1. Now, our condition is that the orbital quantum number is minus L to plus L, where L is the maximum value of the azimuthal quantum number, N minus 1. So here N minus 1 is 0. So M can only be 0 and not any other value. So option D is incorrect. What about option C? N is 3. L is minus 3. Now this is where the problem lies, because the value of L ranges from 0 to n minus 1. So the lowest value for L is 0 and not negative. So option C is incorrect. The right answer is option B. N is 2, which is correct. L is 0, ranges from 0 to n minus 1. M is 0, again minus L to plus L. And the spin quantum number is minus half, indicating a negative spin. So all of these are correct. And that makes option B the right combination of quantum numbers. Let's move on to our next question. Arrange the following groupings which represent the collection of isoelectronic species. Now, isoelectronic means same number of electrons. So their electronic configuration will give you the total number of electrons as the same. So let's look at each of our options. Now, option A contains NO plus, C22 minus, O2 minus, and CO. Let's check out each of their electrons. So NO plus means that we have nitrogen, which has the atomic number 7, so 7 electrons, plus oxygen, which has the atomic number 8, so 8 electrons. And since there's a plus on the top, that implies a loss of electrons. So plus means plus 1, so that is a loss of 1 electron, so minus 1. So 7 plus 8 is 15, minus 1 is 14 electrons. For C22 minus, we have 2 carbon atoms, so that is 6 plus 6, and then 2 minus indicates addition of 2 electrons, so plus 2. So 6 plus 6 is 12, 12 plus 2 is 14 electrons. So far, so good. What about O2 minus? Now, O2 minus means two atoms of oxygen, so that means 8 plus 8, and a minus implies an extra electron. So 8 plus 8 is 16, 16 plus 1 is 17 electrons. Now, the addition of oxygen implies that this four species are not isoelectronic, so option A is incorrect. Let's find out the electrons of CO, so that will be helpful for us in future in finding out the remaining options. So CO, that is carbon 6 plus oxygen is 8, and so that is equal to 14 electrons. Now, in option B, N2, we need to find that out. So N2 will give you 2 atoms of nitrogen, so 7 plus 7, whose sum is equal to 14 electrons. So 14. Yes, C22 minus again gives you 14, so that's correct. CO again gives you 14, that's correct. However, we have the last species as NO. NO is just 7 plus 8, there is no minus 1 because there is no charge on the species. So 7 plus 8 gives you 15 electrons. So because of that, option B is also incorrect. Let's jump into option D. NO gives you 15 electrons, okay. CN minus, let's find that out. CN minus, so carbon is 6 plus nitrogen is 7 plus 1 that because of the charge. So 6 plus 7 is 13, 13 plus 1 is 14 electrons. So by looking at that, we find that it's different. And here N2 is 14 and O22 minus is 17. So CN minus and O22 minus are completely different. So option D is incorrect. Therefore, the right answer is option C, CO, NO plus, CN minus, and C22 minus. As you can see, CO has 14 electrons, NO plus has 14 electrons, CN minus has 14 electrons, and C22 minus also has 14 electrons. So this represents a group of isoelectronic species. Option C is the right option. Let's move on to our next question. The electrons identified by quantum numbers N and L, so we have a set of 4 electrons, can be placed in the order of increasing energy from the lowest to highest as given. So we need to find out which of these has the lowest energy, which of these has the highest energy, and we need to arrange it in that order, in increasing order of energy. So how do we do it? In order to find the energy of electrons, we have 2 rules. Rule number 1 states that the electron which has the larger n plus l value will have more energy. And rule 2 states that if the n plus l value is same for two electrons, then we need to check the number n, the principal quantum number, which of them has a higher principal quantum number. If their n plus l value is same, will have more energy. So having said that, let's move on to each of our scenarios. So the first electron has n is equal to 4 and l is equal to 1. So that means its n plus l value will be equal to 5. For the second electron, we have n is equal to 4 and l is equal to 0. So its n plus l value is equal to 4. For the third electron, we have n is equal to 3, we have l is equal to 2, so its n plus l value is equal to 5. And for the fourth one, we have n is equal to 3, l is equal to 1, and we have the n plus l value as 4. So over here, we found that 1 and 3 have the same n plus l value, which is 5. 2 and 4 have the same n plus l value. Now, since the n plus l value of 1 and 3 is greater than 2 plus 4, 2 and 4, so electrons 1 and 3 have more energy than electrons 2 and 4. Now, among 1 and 3, we need to find out which of these has more energy. So we know that the value of n of the first electron is 4, while for the third electron, n is equal to 3. So electron 3 has less energy than electron 1. And similarly, in the second and fourth electrons, we find that the second electron has n is equal to 4, and the fourth electron has n is equal to 3. So that is how we find out the order of the electrons. So our order will be the fourth as the lowest, followed by the second, followed by the third, and then followed by the first. So the fourth has the least energy and the first has the highest energy. Now, if you look at our options, you would see that it is equal to option A. If we look at option A, we find that the fourth electron is first, so it's lowest, followed by 2, which is higher, then 3, which is higher, and 1 is the highest. And after using our rules in order to find out the order of increasing energy, we can say that this option, which is option A, is the right option. Now, let's move on to the next question. In a hydrogen atomic spectrum, a series limit I is found at 12186.3 centimeters per centimeter. Then it belongs to A, Lyman series, B, Baumol series, C, Pastian series, and D, Brackett series. So how do we solve this question? The given value here is 12186.3 centimeter inverse. Now, centimeter inverse will give you the idea that the quantity here is wave number. So this is known as wave number. And we know that the value is also called the series limit. So the series limit means the last line of a series. So the series refer to the series of spectral lines. So electrons, when moving from one energy level to another, they emit radiation, which can be detected as spectral lines. So a series limit refers to the last line of a series of spectral lines. And the last line always comes from infinity towards the series in question. So therefore, the value of N2 will be equal to infinity. Now, how do you find the wave number? Wave number is found out by the following formula. V is equal to R into 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square. Now, over here, V is the wave number, and R here refers to the Rydberg constant. and the value of the Rydberg constant is 109677.76, and N1 is the first spectral line in the series of spectral lines, and the first spectral line usually gives the series its name. So the value of N1 would give us the value the which of these series is the series limit belonging to. So now N2, which is the last spectral line, that is known as series limit. So let's start solving this question. So let's plug in the value of the wave number. So V is equal to 12,186.3 is equal to R is the Rydberg constant. So that is 109677.76, and then times 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 is given as infinity. So infinity square would still give you infinity. So 1 by N1 square minus 1 by infinity. Now we know that 1 by infinity will be equal to 0. So we can write this as 109677.76 divided by N1 square. The reason being 1 by infinity is 0, so 1 by N1 square minus 0 will give you 1 by N1 square. So 12186.3. Now let's find out the value of N1 square. N1 square is equal to 109677.76 divided by 12186.3. Let's simplify both the numerator and the denominator by removing the decimal. So over here we need to multiply by 100 to make it a whole number. So let's multiply by 100 on the numerator and the denominator. So it'll be 109677.76 divided by 12186.30. So now we need to divide this colossal sum. However, there's a trick to this. We don't need to divide this completely. You notice that the first two, digits are 12. So when we multiply 12 times 9, 2 nines are 18, 1 9 is 9, 9 plus 1 is 10. That gives you 108. And 108 is very close to 109, the first three digits of the numerator. So this gives us the idea that we just need to multiply the denominator by 9 in order to approximately match the numerator. Let's do it. So 12186.30 times 9. 0 times 9 is 0. 3 times 9 is 27. 6 times 9 is 54, 54 plus 2, 56, and 8 times 9 is 72, 72 plus 5 is 77, 1 times 9 is 9, 9 plus 7 is 16, 2 times 9 is 18, 18 plus 1 is 19, and 1 times 9 is 9, 9 plus 1 is equal to 10. So we have 109677670, which is very close to 109677.76. So what we can do is we can write N1 square as approximately equal to 9. So therefore N1 is approximately equal to the root under root of 9, which is approximately equal to 3. So therefore the value of N1 is equal to 3. So we know that the value of N1 is 3. But how do we know which of the series does this spectral limit belong to? Now over here, we have studied a lot of series. So we know of the Lyman series, the Balmer series, the Pastian series, the Brackett series, the PFUN series and the Humphrey series. Now, we have the values of N1 here. For Lyman series, the value of N1 is 1. For Bomber series, it's 2. For Pastian series, it's 3. For Brackett, it's 4. For PFUN series, it's 5. And for Humphrey series, it is 6. So this is a list that you need to remember, which is these are the values of N1. And if the value of N1 is from 1 to 6, you will find out which particular series does this belong to. So we know that our value of N1 is 3. So therefore, we can safely conclude that our series is, so our series limit belongs to the Pastian series. So option C is the right option. Now, let's move on to our next question. Based on the equation, which is E is equal to minus 2.178 into 10 raised to minus 18 joules, Z square by N square, certain conclusions are written. Which of them is not correct? A, larger the value of N, the larger is the orbit radius. B, equation can be used to calculate the change in energy when the electron changes orbit. C, for N is equal to 1, the electron has a more negative energy than it does for N is equal to 6, which means that the electron is more loosely bound at the smallest allowed orbit. D, the negative sign in equation simply means that the energy or electron bound to the nucleus is lower than it would be if the electrons were at the infinite distance from the nucleus. We need to find out which of them is not correct. So we're going to check out each of the statements and find out which of these are true and which one is false. And the false statement will give you our correct answer. So, larger the value of N, the larger is the orbit radius. Since here, N is written as an inverse to E, so energy is inversely proportional to the principal quantum number, we can safely say that when the value of N is larger, the energy is smaller. So when energy is smaller, that would indicate that the orbit radius will be larger. So statement A is true, which makes the option incorrect. What about option B? Equation can be used to calculate the change in energy when the electron changes orbit. So since E is equal to minus 2.18 into 10 raised to minus 18 joules into Z square by N square. So here Z square refers to the atomic number and N square refers to the principal quantum number. So principal quantum number refers to the orbit. So therefore, when the electron changes orbit, we can calculate the change in energy. So option B is true, which makes it incorrect. What about option D? The negative sign in equation simply means that the energy or electron bound to the nucleus is lower than it would be if the electrons were at the infinite distance from the nucleus. When electrons are at infinite distance, the energy of the electrons is equal to zero because there is no attraction or repulsion. So as the electron reaches the nucleus, it gets attracted. So when it gets attracted, it becomes more stable. So the energy of the electron is lower. And that's why we have a negative sign in the equation right here. So this statement is also true, which makes option D incorrect. The right answer is option C. For N is equal to 1, the electron has a more negative energy than it does for N is equal to 6, which means that the electron is more loosely bound in the smallest allowed orbit. Now, the reason why this is wrong is because of the fact that when an electron is closer to the nucleus, it feels more attraction. And when it has more attraction, it is more tightly bound. While the option here states that when N is equal to 1, the electron is more loosely bound, which is incorrect. So the statement is false, which makes the option correct. Again, the reason why we're taking out the false statement is because we need to find out which of these is not correct. Let's move on to the next question. Let MP be the mass of a proton, MN be the mass of a neutron, M1 that of a neon nucleus, and M2 that of a calcium nucleus. So for neon and calcium, the atomic number and mass number are given. So we need to find out which of the following relations is true. So for any element which has atomic number Z and mass number A, we can represent it as in this scenario. So we find that the mass number is written on the top left, the atomic number is written on the top in the bottom left, and E would represent this element symbol. So now we have our first element, which is 2010 neon. So over here, we have atomic number as 10 and mass number as 20. So atomic number would give you the number of protons in an atom, because atom does not have any charge. And the mass number would give you the number of protons plus the number of neutrons. The reason being that protons give you charge and mass. However, neutrons only gives you mass and no charge. So that implies that neon has 10 protons and 10 neutrons. So the mass of neon, which is M1, will be equal to 10 times the mass of a proton plus 10 times the mass of a neutron. So it'll be 10 times MP plus MN. Now let's find out the same for calcium. So 40 Ca 20. So over here we know that the atomic number is 20 and the mass number is 40. So 20 is the number of protons and 40 represents the number of protons plus number of neutrons. So calcium has 20 protons and 20 neutrons. So the mass of calcium, which is represented as M2, will be equal to 20 times MP plus MN. Now notice that we can write this as 2 times 10 into MP plus MN. So 10 into MP plus MN is just M1, so we can write M2 as 2 times of M1. And this is the relation that we need to find out. And which of the options gives you that relation? Option A. So we find that option A, M2 is equal to 2 times of M1, is the right option because of our calculation by first understanding how an element is represented and finding out the number of protons in an atom and number of neutrons in an atom as well. So using that, we found out that M2 is equal to 2 times of M1. Now let's move on to the next question. Which transition in the hydrogen atomic spectrum will have the same wavelength as the transition n is equal to 4 to n is equal to 2 of helium plus spectrum? So the transition that's given to us is n is equal to 4 to n is equal to 2 of helium plus spectrum. So what happens is an electron is moving from the fourth orbit of helium plus towards the second orbit. And now we need to find out the wave number. So wave number, the actual formula of wave number is Z square R times 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square. The reason why in the previous question we avoided Z square is because of the fact that hydrogen has an atomic number 1. So it doesn't affect. However, for helium, things change because helium has atomic number 2. So 2 square times R, let's keep R as it is. And here N1 will be the new orbit where the electron rests, and N2 will be the original. So therefore, it'll be 1 by 2 square minus 1 by 4 square. So that'll be 4R times 1 by 4 minus 1 by 16. That gives you 4R into 16, gives you the 16 is the LCM here. So that is 4 minus 1. So 4R into 3 by 16. 4 goes into 16 four times, so we got 3R by 4 as the wave number for the transition of an electron from the fourth orbit to the second orbit of a helium plus spectrum. Now, we know that in the question, the transition in a hydrogen atomic spectrum will be equal to the wave number given here, the wave number of a transition in the hydrogen atomic spectrum will be equal to the transition that we just found out. So we know that the wave number will be equal. However, we need to find out the value of N1 and N2. Like from where to where is this transition happening? So for hydrogen, we know that its atomic number is 1. However, we need to find out the N1 and N2 for this transition, and we know that the value of our wave number is equal to 3R by 4 because both the transitions have the same wave number. So let's put in the formula for the wave number once again. V is equal to Z square R into 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square. So Z square is 1 square, which is equal to 1, so that isn't getting represented. So R times 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square is equal to 3R by 4. Now, since both the LHS and the RHS have R in the numerator, let's cancel it. So 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square is equal to 3 by 4. How do you solve this question from now on? If you notice, we can write 3 by 4 as 1 minus 1 by 4. And 1 can be written as 1 by 1 as well. So we can write 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square is equal to 1 by 1 minus 1 by 4. From here, we know that 1 by N1 square is equal to 1 by 1. N1 square is equal to 1. That gives you N1 as 1. And 1 by N2 square is equal to 1 by 4. N2 square is equal to 4. And N2 is equal to 2. So the transition happens from N is equal to 2 to N is equal to 1 in a hydrogen atomic spectrum. And the value and the wave number for that will be equal to the wave number of the transition N is equal to 4 to N is equal to 2 of a helium plus spectrum. So after getting our answers, we notice that N2 is equal to 2 and N1 is equal to 1. So option D gives us the right answer. So option D is the right option for which transition will have the same wavelength. Now here you notice that I've used wave number. It is pretty easy to convert it to wavelength because wave number is equal to 1 by lambda, where lambda is the wavelength. Now, let's look at our final question. In the Bohr series of lines of hydrogen spectrum, the third line from the red end corresponds to which one of the following interorbit jumps of the electron for Bohr orbits in an atom of hydrogen? So, we need to find out which of these transitions is the correct one. But for that, we need to find out N1 and N2. How do we find out the value of N1 and N2? Now, in this scenario, if you notice the fragment, the third line from the red end. So if you've learned about the series of spectral lines for atomic spectrum of hydrogen, you would know that the Balmer series is the only one which contains visible light. The first one, which is the Lyman series, happens in ultraviolet, and all the other series happens in infrared. So the Balmer series is the only one which has visible light in it. So since it says the third line from the red end, we are pretty sure that the question indicates a Balmer series. That implies N1 is equal to 2. How do you find the value of N2? Now, N2 is just N1 plus 1, and then N1 plus 2, and then N1 plus 3, etc. So basically, this is a series of spectral lines. So N2, which is the orbital from which the electron is jumping, will be at least one orbit greater than the orbit to which it is jumping. So for example, if an orbital here is jumping to the second orbit, then for the Balmer series to work, the first electron has to jump from the third. So from the third to second, it emits energy in the form of visible light. So that spectral line will be inside the Balmer series. Now over here, it says the third line. So third line would give you the value of N2 as N1 plus 3, because here we are looking for the third line. So the third case in which it happens, N1 is 2 plus 3, so N2 is equal to 5. And since we have N2 is equal to 5 and N1 is equal to 2, we can safely conclude that option A is the right option. Now notice that C and A are similar. However, we've noticed that N2 is the orbital from which the electron is jumping, and N1 is the orbital into which the electron is moving in after the jump. So after releasing energy, it goes into N1 and it jumps from N2 while releasing energy. So 5 will be the value of N2 and 2 will be the value of N1. So when you're representing a transition, we always write N2 first and then N1. So that's why option A is correct, while option C is incorrect. So that concludes this video of NEET preparation. Now, there are a lot of questions in NEET examinations about the chapter structure of atoms. So we've created other videos as well regarding the chapter. So what we can do is we'll be providing the link in the description down below. So you can click there and you can watch the other videos as well, the previous videos for the chapter in the playlist NEET preparation for physics. No, I mean chemistry, because this is a chapter of chemistry. And we also have other educational content such as learner words, mind maps, memory hacks, etc. So if you want to access our content, then please subscribe to our channel, Brain Blitz Audios. You can also hit the bell icon, which is the notifications button, for getting our latest and most useful content so that you don't miss out on any of our educational content. So until the next episode of NEET preparation, take care, stay safe, bye-bye for now.